Praise the servants of the Lord, praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Almighty and gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we come in thy presence, O Lord, to praise you, to worship you, to glorify you, for thou art worthy. Worthy, O Lord, to receive all praise, glory, and honor. And most, Lord, we pray that you will take control of our minds and hearts at this time, so that we may be able to worship you, Lord, in spirit and in truth, and receive your word which you want to give us this morning. We commit all of us in thy hands, O Lord. And Lord, if there are others who are still coming, we pray that you may bring them by their grace, that all of us may partake of the many, many blessings that you are to give us this morning. Towards this end, we commit ourselves, O Master, in thy almighty arms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's continue worshipping the Lord by turning in our songbooks at this time to song number 56. Song number 56. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. And we'll rise to our feet and join in this beautiful hymn. understanding, let's turn our Bibles at this time to Psalms 23. Psalms 23. And we're going to join in the responsive reading of this psalm. I'll read one part of the verse and you can respond with the remaining. Right? So we won't read it verse by verse, but rather I'll read one part of the verse, you can respond with the next. The Lord is my shepherd.
I shall not be in want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures.
He leads me beside quiet waters.
He restores my soul.
He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me.
Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Let's bow our heads in prayer, prayer of thanksgiving and also prayer of intercession. Even as we have bowed down in the presence of a holy God, we sang that song of holiness unto the Lord, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of thy glory. Let us know that we have come into the presence of a holy God, a God who knows no sin, a God who abhors sin. A God who has destroyed people, even as you see in the Old Testament, because of their sins. No one could go into his presence. And yet we know that the Lord has done marvelous things for us, that he has opened the way for us. The curtain has been torn into two and we have access into the presence of a holy God in the Holy of Holies. Even as the Lord is enthroned between the cherubim, let's remember that he is enthroned on his mercy seat. And he has forgiven us our sins. And he has made us his children. He has given us his Holy Spirit, through whom we can call him our Father. And as a Father, he has taken care of all our needs. Be it our spiritual needs, for he has made us his children. He has washed away our sins. He has redeemed us from the power of sin. He has made known to us the mystery of his will. He has given us the Holy Spirit. And all this because he has lavished his grace upon us. Let us just lift up our hearts unto the Lord and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you have done. Acknowledge before the Lord that without his grace in our lives, we would all end up in eternal damnation. But His grace, which is sufficient for all times, the power of the cross and the blood that He has shed, has redeemed us from our past, present, and future sins. It's time to just praise and worship the Lord. Thank the Lord. Yes, Lord, thank you. Thank the Lord for all His provisions in our life. He has given us shelter, food, clothing, families, children, grandchildren, finances, jobs, businesses. He has given us His security. He has been our strength, our ever-present help in trouble. Kept us safe and sound, especially in this pandemic. Made us see this particular day in our lives, which many people have not been able to see. Just lift up the name of the Lord, ask the Lord, just thank the Lord for what He has done in your life. It's time to intercede also, intercede for the world. So many people suffering because of various reasons, the pandemic being one, but there are many, many other reasons that the people are suffering in this world. Due to poverty, due to diseases, people have lost their near and dear ones, people have lost their jobs. So many people living in hopelessness. It's time to lift up all these people to the throne of grace of our God. Let's pray this time for the church, the Catholic Church, the whole church, irrespective of the denominations, we are all one in Jesus Christ. Thank God for the solidarity that we have. And yet we know that we are divided by so many doctrines, we are divided by so many petty things. Our Lord Jesus Christ has said, let them be one even as I am one, so that the world may know that you have sent me. How good it is when brothers live in unity. Let's pray for the unity of the church at this time. All denominations joining hands together, leaving aside petty differences, petty doctrines, knowing that the blood of Jesus Christ has united all of us to become the one body of Jesus Christ. Let's pray for all the believers that they may be strengthened in the Lord, learn to live by faith, irrespective of the circumstances, keep their focus upon the Lord Jesus, knowing that He has already achieved eternity for them. A few days of trial, but there is a lifetime of eternity and joy in the presence of the Lord. Pray that people known by our Lord Jesus Christ's name may all stand firm at this time. Even as there are so many forces acting against the church, acting against the believers. Cultural factors, communal factors, pray that we may all come out victorious. Pray for all those who are working in God's vineyard, be it pastors, evangelists, missionaries. Pray for strength for them. Pray that their families may be strong in the Lord. Pray that the Lord may provide for their families. And pray that the harvest may be cut. Many people who do not know the Lord may come into His kingdom. Pray for all those who are outside the kingdom of the Lord, that they may come and enjoy God's presence, enjoy eternity. Pray for all those areas where the word of God has not gone, the witness of our Lord Jesus Christ has not gone, that God may send out His laborers to all those areas, that His word may go very powerfully to all people. Pray for the City Light Fellowship and our daughter church, Shama Fellowship. Pray for us that God may continue to use us for His glory. God may provide all our needs and all that we are doing, be it the Bible school, be it the spiritual mapping, be it the English church here, the Islam church, all that may glorify the name of the Lord, and all the needs of this fellowship may be met in and through our Lord Jesus Christ. Father Lord, we want to thank You and praise You, Master, for this wonderful time You've given us in Thy presence. Let Your name be praised, God, and let Your name be adored is our prayer this morning. We commit ourselves into Thy almighty arms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to read from Scripture this time. There are two Scripture readings, both from the New Testament. The first reading is taken from Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9 and verses 36 to 43. 36 to 43. Paul, have been able to find it? I'll request Naveen can come forward and lead us in this reading. Acts chapter 9, verses 36 to the end of the chapter.
Acts 9, 36 onwards. In Joppa, there was a disciple named Tabitha. In Greek, her name is Dorcas. She was always doing good and helping the poor. About that time, she became sick and died, and her body was washed and placed in an upstairs room. Lydda was near Joppa, so when the disciples heard that Peter was in Lydda, they sent two men to him and urged him, "Please come at once." Peter went with them, and when he arrived, he was taken upstairs to the room. All the widows stood around him, crying and showing him the robes and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was still with them. Peter sent them all out of the room. Then he got down on his knees and prayed. Turning toward the dead woman, he said, "Tabitha, get up." She opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He took her by the hand and helped her to her feet. Then he called for the believers, especially the widows, and presented her to them alive. This became known all over Joppa, and many people believed in the Lord. Peter stayed in Joppa for some time with a tanner named Simon. May the Lord bless us all.
Right, the second reading is taken from the New Testament itself, Revelation chapter 7, Revelation chapter 7 and verses 9 to the end of the chapter. Revelation 7 and 9 to the end of the chapter. And I'll request Ravi to come forward and lead us in this reading.
Revelations chapter 7, 9 onwards. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve Him day and night in His temple. And He who sits on the throne will spread His tent over them. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat upon them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of God.
Well, this is the time that we're going to spend in worshiping and praising the Lord. I'll request Anaya and the whole team to come forward and lead us in songs of praise and worship.
God, for this beautiful opportunity that He has given us to worship Him this morning, and we pray that His presence may be filled in His sanctuary and that His name may be lifted even as we worship Him. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 6 says, "In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins." Once there was a police officer who stopped a woman who was riding a car with her young daughter without the required booster seat. So the woman should have been charged for a penalty. But instead, the police officer took her to a nearby shop and brought her the required car seat, which the woman was not able to purchase. We too have a similar relationship with Christ. We too experience a similar thing in Christ. We deserve penalty for the wrong that we have done. We deserve punishment for the sins that we have committed. But because of Jesus, we experience that undeserved favor and grace day in and day out, in spite of knowing what Jesus has done for us. Unknowingly and knowingly, we sin. We do wrong by our thoughts, by our words, by our deeds. But only because of Jesus, we experience that grace. So our hearts should be full of gratitude and full of happiness for what Jesus has done for us. So with a grateful heart, let us lift His name on high. Let us sing His praises. Let us shout to the Lord even as we sing, "Lord, I lift Your name on high."
I'm so glad You came to save us,
Jesus.
glad you came to save us.
Jesus,
you came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my death to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift to me on high.
Lord, I lift to name on high.
And we lift his name on high because he is the King of Kings, he is the Lord of Lords, he is worthy of our praises. So let us enthrone him on our praises this morning.
The King is exalted on high,
and I praise him.
He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Because he is our maker, he is our creator, he is our sustainer, our provider, he is my rock, my refuge, my strength. When we believe that he is my Jesus, my friend and my father, it is with that conviction that we can say, my Jesus and my Savior, I worship you this morning because you alone are worthy. In spite of my unworthiness, even when I was not worthy of it, even when I did not deserve it, you loved me, and you loved me first. And hence we can say, my Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. There is none like you. I want to praise the wonders of your mind.
Nothing which compares to the promises which our Lord has done for us, which our Lord has given us. He walked alone on that road to Calvary for our sins. He took upon the penalty for our sake. Because He is a wonderful Savior, He is a merciful Savior. My dear friends, let us sing this next song prayerfully. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb would rescue the souls of men?
Continue in prayer. We have sung some very beautiful songs unto the Lord. And I want to open up this time for us to just lift up the name of the Lord and praise Him. And we are going to do it in just one sentence. Lord, I praise You because, and then you can add what you want. You can add the characteristic of the Lord. You can add the name of the Lord there. You can add what God has done for you. But just do it in one sentence. Lord, I thank You. I praise You because. Do not make it an intercession. Do not make it too long. Just one sentence. And as many of us who want to just lift up the name of the Lord, this is the time.
Worship You, Lord, because You are my Jehovah Jireh. Thank You, Father.
Lord, You are our Savior, and we just want to thank You and praise You. Worship You,
I praise You, Lord, because You are my best friend. praise you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, I praise you, Lord, for sustaining us.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, for giving us the free gift of salvation.
Yes,
thank you, Jesus.
Yes, Father Lord, we continue to worship you and to praise you, God. Even if you had 1,000 tongues, God, we know that would not be enough for what you've done for us and what you continue to do for us. In spite of our rebellion against you at times, in spite of our doubts against you, in spite of unbelief, God, you never leave us. Thank you, Lord. Accept our praises in and through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. A very warm welcome, my dear friends, to this worship service. I welcome all of you in the most precious name of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We've got a lot of guests with us today. Of course, Karuna and the family is there. We'd like to welcome them in our midst, and they'll be with us for the full month. So if you want to enjoy more songs, you know, of course, Sudeep and Shama have been leading in wonderful praise and time of worship. But maybe different kinds of praise and worship, if you want to enjoy them, the next 4 weeks are there for us to take advantage of their stay here. Of course, we have Anil and their family here with us, Mona's brother and Mona's father also. And we'd like to welcome them also in our midst. And may the Lord add his blessings through this service to all of you, and through your stay with us, may God continue to bless us. Today is Mother's Day, right? All over the world, it is celebrated as Mother's Day, and many churches also celebrate this day as Mother's Day. And we would like to wish all mothers a very, very happy Mother's Day. It's a great privilege to be a mother, and a great responsibility also, right? The house runs on mothers. It is said to be run on fathers. But all fathers here will agree that it's the mothers who run the houses, right? In fact, I've done a study on joint families, and in joint families, it is the male who runs the house. But when it becomes nuclear families, when they come to cities, it is the women around which the house rotates, right? Am I right or wrong?
Absolutely.
All right, the men are very silent, right? But nevertheless, yeah. A very happy Mother's Day to all mothers here, and may the Lord continue to bless you all, and may the Lord continue to give you all strength to guide the house, guide your children, guide your family in the way of the Lord. Amrit Samuel, that is Sam's son, he celebrates his birthday today. We'd like to wish him a very happy birthday. Our next Sunday service will be at the same time, that is at 9 in the morning. Then all of us are invited for the same. And you can tell your other friends also, and bring them also to the service. As I announced last Sunday, Mr. Thomas, who comes here, he has got a heart attack, in fact. You know, this was on Good Friday that he had gone to work, and he suffered a heart attack, but he works in Maninagar, you know, near Kokra. So he came back on a scooter in that very condition. After that, he went to the hospital. You know, so he's, I think a stent has been put, and of course he's at home, but we need to continue to pray for him. Okay? All right. This is the time that we will say the Apostles' Creed from the communion sheet that we have. The communion sheet that is there, we'll rise to our feet and join in the Apostles' Creed. The creed that is there, it basically gives us our belief, right? What do we actually believe? There are many churches that we know who recite this every Sunday, right? And rightly so, We do it once in a month, and there are some churches who do not even know what is an Apostles' Creed, especially the new churches that are there. You know, the so-called charismatic churches, you ask them and they won't even know what is a creed all about. And though they may boast of a lot of, you know, new theology or the new way of worship, many a times they lack in the basic foundation of what Christian faith is. That's very important that we know. Sometimes it becomes very routine, but nevertheless, it is important that we know what our creed is, and this is one of the first creeds that was made. Right, so let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. This is the time that we'll bring our offerings unto the Lord. We're going to sing one hymn at this time, hymn number 646, Break Thou the Bread of Life. Right, and we'll bring our offerings unto the Lord, and I'm going to request Abigail to come and take the offering for us. Thank you. and join in the doxology. And praise the Master for all good blessings that you give us in our life. And Father, even as we bring this little offering to you, we pray that you will bless it, Lord, and use it for the extension of your kingdom. Bless our lives, God, even as we turn to your word. Pray that your word may come alive to us, may grow in your word, Master. Yes, Father, Lord, we continue praying, Lord, for Amrit, who is celebrating his birthday today, that you will bless him, O Master, in all that he does, and let's bless this day for him. And let your name be glorified in and through him, O God. We pray, Master, for all mothers here. Even as we celebrate Mother's Day, Lord, we want to thank you and praise you for each one of them. Thank you and praise you for our mothers, Lord, who are not with us, who are with you. And thank you, praise you for all their sacrifices, O God, in our lives and all that they have done for us. We remember with gratitude, O Master, Lord, all that they have done. And the mothers that are here, Lord, we commit them into the hands, pray that you will continue to bless them, that they may guide, O Lord, their families in your way, Master. Yes, Father, we just commit each one of them with our almighty arms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. All right, the gospel reading for today has been taken from the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 10, verses 22 to 30. In the New Testament, the Gospel according to St. John, in chapter 10, verses 22 to 30. And it reads, "Then came the feast of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple area walking in the Solomon's colonnade. The Jews gathered around him, saying, 'How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly.' Jesus answered, 'I did tell you, but you do not believe. The miracles I do in my Father's name speak for me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one.'" May the Lord add his blessings to the reading and hearing of his holy word. Right, even as you would have read on our WhatsApp group, that the title of today's message is Jesus the Good Shepherd. Jesus the Good Shepherd, and we're going to look at that whole concept of God being our shepherd and what he does for us being our shepherds and what he expects from us being his sheep. Jesus gave several images of who he is, and one of them is the image of a shepherd. And when he spoke of he being the shepherd, he also spoke of his followers being the sheep. All right? So it would be prudent for us to know what Jesus really wanted to convey through this particular image that he gave us, so that that can become the anchor of our life and a life belt for our souls. This is a very, very important image or imagery that Jesus gave of his own self. And it is only John who kind of puts or who has written about this. And John chapter 10 is probably the only place where we get Jesus as a shepherd, apart from, of course, this image as we read in also in Revelations. In John chapter 10 and verses 11 and 14, these are two verses where Jesus Christ very clearly said that he is the good shepherd. If you see verse 11, it says, "I am the good shepherd. That's the Jesus Christ called himself the good shepherd. Again in verse 14, I am the good shepherd. And Jesus, after this, used the feast of dedication that we read about in verse 22 to actually expound this whole idea of he being the shepherd and we being the sheep. And we are told here that it was winter time, late December, and probably one of the darkest parts of the year as far as Israel is concerned. And this feast of dedication is basically celebrated to commemorate the fire at the altar that Nehemiah had built after he had built the wall. Right? Nehemiah, we know, was living in Babylon, in Persia basically. And then he came to build the wall that was broken down. And after building that wall in a record time of just 52 days, we know that he lit the fire in the temple, and that was around 445 BC. And then in 167 BC, the Syrian king Antiochus Epiphanes, he desecrated the altar by sacrificing that which was abominable to the Lord, putting something as a sacrifice which was not acceptable to the Lord. But again in 165 BC, that is 2 years later, Judas Maccabeus, he cleansed the temple and relit the fire on the same day that it was put off. And this feast of dedication, which is also known as the Feast of Lights or Hanukkah, was centered on Jerusalem, the dedication of the temple, the restoration of worship, and the return of God's presence, his Shekinah glory. I hope you understand this. You know, 445 is Nehemiah, who started or lit the altar fire, and then in 167 BC, the fire was put off by the Syrian king. But 165 BC, on the same day that it was put off, it was put on again. And here, the feast of dedication was to remember that, and expect the glory of the Lord to come back into the temple, as it had been when the temple was built. All right, so this is the background or the context in which Jesus Christ is speaking about he being the good shepherd. The expectation of God's Shekinah glory. Right? You understand Shekinah glory. His glory that had entered the temple, that was there between the cherubims. That glory. And the question that is being put to Jesus Christ after all that he explains, right? If you see right from verse 1 onwards, right up to verse 21, Jesus time and again speaks of he being the good shepherd, he being the shepherd. And yet, what is the question that is being asked to him in verse 24?
How long do you keep us in suspense?
Yeah, suspense about what? Are you the Christ? Are you the Christ? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. And we know that Jesus Christ, what is the answer then? In verse 25, he says, I did tell you. I did tell you very plainly who I am. The fact that I am the Messiah. I am the one you are waiting for. And yet you did not believe. And then he goes on to say in that very verse, the miracles I do in my Father's name, you know, they speak plainly for me. And time and again I told you that John's gospel basically is based on the miracles of Jesus Christ. He writes about the miracles of Jesus Christ, some of the teachings of Jesus Christ, some of the images that Jesus Christ gave. And then at the end in chapter 20 and verse 30 and 31, John says that there are many, many things that that Jesus Christ did, which I have not written here, but these things I have written so that you may believe, and believing you may get eternal life. You may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, Jesus is the Christ, Jesus is the Son of God. And believing that, you may get eternal life. So Jesus says, I have told you plainly, and my works that I have done in my Father's name, the miracles that I have done, they speak very plainly of who I am. And yet you still are not ready to listen. In fact, what was Jesus Christ saying? As I just explained, that the people were celebrating this particular festival called Hanukkah, where they were expecting the Shekinah glory of the Lord to come back. The glory of the Lord, let's forget that name Shekinah, alright? The glory of the Lord to come back in the temple. They were expecting God to come back in the temple. And what is Jesus Christ saying? God has come back. What you are expecting has already happened, but you are not ready to believe it. You're not ready to believe it because of your preconceived notions. Your minds are so clouded with your preconceived notions that you're just not able to see who I am, in spite of the evidence being so very, very plain before you. But Jesus Christ also said, my dear friends, that there are people. There are people here who have recognized who I am, and they are my sheep. So even today, my dear friends, has the situation changed? Still today, there are people who ask questions similar to what the Jews were asking at that particular time. What are some of the questions that people ask? Christians, my dear friends, what are some of the questions that Christians ask? Some of the questions that maybe non-Christians ask. Can really Jesus give us eternal life? Or, Jesus, are you the only way? Or are there other ways also? What about those who believe something else than what we believe? What about them? Are their beliefs also not as sophisticated as our belief? Are they not going to heaven? Is it that only we who believe in Jesus Christ will go to heaven? A lot of questions of this sort, my dear friends, people come up with. How is it that you died on the cross and your blood can wash our sins? How is that possible? Well, what is it? What is the answer that Jesus Christ gives? Jesus Christ gives, I have given the answer to all these questions in when I came here. Right? All the necessary questions that need to be answered, I have answered. And I have given enough evidence of who I am. And yet, if you do not believe, what does Jesus Christ say? What does Jesus Christ do to these Jews who did not believe? You are not my sheep. He just let them go. He just let them go. And Jesus does the same today also. He says, if you are not able to believe what I have already given you, and you come up with things that you may not be important to you, why is this not here? Why is this not here? Why is this not here? These are things we keep on asking instead of dwelling on what is there. Enough evidence is there in the Bible of who Jesus Christ is and what He has given us. If Jesus Christ claimed to be God, my dear friends, the empty tomb, it proves who Jesus Christ is. It ratifies, God the Father ratified the claims of Jesus Christ. So enough proof is there. And yet, if we choose not to believe, in that case, my dear friends, I don't think that even God can do anything for us. But for those who believe, He says, they are my sheep. And there are a list of marvelous blessings, my dear friends, that that are in store for us, for those who believe, those who are a sheep. And whether we want to partake of these great blessings, you know, it depends upon us. We need to decide whether I need these blessings, I'm going to take these blessings, or I'm going to live according to my own way. Right? So the imagery, the imagery of the shepherd and the sheep that Jesus Christ gives, it presumes a relationship. You see verse 27 of John chapter 10, where Jesus Christ says, my sheep listen to my voice, I know them and they follow me. Very important verse, right? First thing he says, my sheep listen to my voice. That means the sheep know the shepherd. If they listen to his voice and they recognize the voice of the shepherd, right? This example everyone would be knowing, that even if you know, 1,000 sheep are grazing somewhere, and there are 5 or 10 shepherds there. Each sheep knows the shepherd. Right? When the time comes, it is the sheep who will give his particular, call, or he gives a particular signal, and his sheep are going to follow him because they know his voice. They know who our shepherd is. And so that's the first thing, that the sheep, my dear friends, know the shepherd, know the voice of the shepherd. Secondly, it says, I know them. I know them. That means Jesus says, my sheep know me, they know my voice, and I know them. The word used for know in Greek is ginosko, and this word actually means not knowing someone intuitively, right, but knowing someone experientially. That means knowing someone in and out, knowing someone, knowing everything of a particular person. And Jesus Christ says that if my sheep recognize my voice, they know me, they listen to my voice, I know them in and out. I know every aspect of their being. There's nothing in their life of my sheep that I do not know. And then it says that they, what does it say? It says, and they follow me, and they follow me. And the Greek word used for follow, my dear friends, it actually means fellowship with me. The sheep have a strong fellowship with me. What a great words, what a great image, my dear friends, imagery that is there. My sheep know my voice, I know them, and we have a strong fellowship with each other. I have kept saying this in the past few weeks, my dear friends, that where does the relation start? It starts by with being born again. And born again, my dear friends, does not presume that we come from a Christian background. Our forefathers may have been Christians, 2 generations, 3 generations. It doesn't make us Christian at all. We may have a Christian name. It may be Robin, or it may be Glenn, or it may be anything. But that does not make us Christian at all. Our surname may be Christian, it does not make us Christian. Christians mean, at a particular point of time in our life, consciously or unconsciously, we have made that decision, or we have recognized Jesus as our Savior and have accepted Him in our life as our Savior and our Lord. That's the beginning of that relationship. All right? So we need to be very, very clear on this. Being born again, don't take this lightly at all. We need to be clear on the fact that we are born again. We may know the date that we are born again. We may know the incident that we are born again. We may not know also. Sometimes it's an unconscious thing that happens. You know, we've been brought up in a Christian family, and at some point of time, we imbibe this. Fine. That's fine. As long as we know very clearly that Jesus has died for me, His blood has been shed for me, it's through His blood that I'm saved. Right, so we need to know this very, very clearly. And what is the evidence, my dear friends? I have spoken of this time and again. What is the evidence that we are born again? What is the first evidence? Let me ask you. What is the evidence that you are married? Certificate is there, of course, but apart from that,
you have a wife.
You have a wife, of course, yeah. And
we have the Holy Spirit with us.
All right, okay. But what is the evidence that the Holy Spirit is there with us?
The fruit of the Spirit.
Okay.
That love which God has given, we constantly keep on sharing it, evangelize.
Okay, even before all that, just think of our husband and wife, yeah? What do you say? Okay. Just think about it, husband and wife, alright? When they go for, maybe if they have problems and if they go for counseling, what is the first thing that the counselor says? How is your communication? How is your communication? Do you all talk to each other? Do you all communicate with each other? Alright? And that is the first evidence of we being born again. Are we talking with our Lord? Are we speaking with Him? Do we have that relationship with Him? Are we hearing from Him? Do we get up every day morning and the first thing that we do is sit with the Bible and say, what does the Lord have to say to me? What do I have to say to the Lord? That is the first evidence. If you're not doing that, my dear friends, and I'm not saying that you read the Bible only in the morning, alright, you may have issues, problems, you may read at any time during the day. You know, we are not legalistic. Any time during the day. But if you're not doing that, that basic communication is not there, you know, there's a big doubt of whether we are born again or not. I'm not judging anyone, but there is a doubt. Alright, so please keep that in mind. Relationship, this relationship, fellowship is important. And what does the Lord give us in this relationship or this fellowship? And for that, probably we have to go to that very, very well-known chapter in the Old Testament, and that is Psalms 23. And all of us know this Psalms 23 and the Psalm of David. And the things that he tells us when he says, the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. And what are the things that he speaks about as far as what the shepherd gives him? There are three P's that I'm going to talk about. First of all, he promises provision. He promised, the shepherd promises provision. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. There's nothing that I will lack. That's what he's saying. And then he goes on to say, he makes me lie down in green pastures and he leads me beside quiet waters. He knows my needs. Right? Not my wants. He knows my needs. He knows what I need. And he provides all my needs. He is Jehovah Jireh for me. And in the Old Testament, of course, we have got ample evidences of God being Jehovah Jireh. Wonderful ways that he provided for his people. Whether it was in the desert, he provided food and water. And what about clothes? Did he provide clothes in the desert? It says clothes did not wear out, all right? Or the slippers, that slippers did not wear out, okay? So he provided food for them. Okay, and water for them. When Elijah had virtually given up, God provided food through ravens. And when the widow asked Elisha for help, my dear friend, God provided enough oil to pay off their debts and have enough food. Now, here is a God who provides. Psalms 34, it says, the young ones of a lion may grow weak, but those who trust in the Lord, they will lack no good thing. And do we believe that? Do we believe that God is a God who provides? There are one or two stories, let me tell you, true stories. This is a story of a pastor in British Columbia, Canada. His name is Bruce Wilcox, and he says that he relates a particular incident. He says he wanted to buy a car, a second-hand car, like what we have. All right, so his car was not working properly, so he went to town and he went to a number of dealers, and somehow he could not get the car that he wanted. Some were priced very high, some were not very good. At the end of the day, he thought that today is not the day. He was going to go back home, and he saw one last dealer. He said, let me go to him. It was time of closing, and he went there, and there was a salesman who told him, his name was Murray. And Murray told him that there's a car which has just come in. It was supposed to come in after a few days, but somehow they have left it here today. Please have a look at the car. And the pastor and his wife and this salesman, they got in the car and they went for a ride. And the pastor immediately knew that this was the car that he was going to take. All right. So when I was reading this story, I said, okay, the God provides. Okay. I thought this is a story. God provides. But the story went on and says that the pastor went, took the car, did all the papers, everything, and it was pretty late, took the car home. And then he talks about the salesman. And the salesman, Murray, he was in need of money, desperately in need of money. And they get money only when they sell a particular car. Right? They would be some amount for eternalship, but only if they're able to sell cars, they would get the bonus. And because he sold that particular car that day, he got that bonus in his hand, which he was desperately in need. And this Murray, even as he was driving around with his pastor, told him that he had become a Christian just a few days back. His brother had led him, you know, to Christ. And he had trusted in the Lord, and the Lord provided for him miraculously. Here is a God, my dear friends, who provides, a God who provides. And we need to experience that in our life, that our God never, never lets us down at any point of time when we need something. He also provides us guidance to walk in paths of righteousness. You see verse 3, second part of verse 3, he says, guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Can someone explain that to me? What does the psalmist mean? He says, he guides me in the paths of righteousness. Yeah?
God guides us in the path which is right, even though we may feel we may take this wrong road.
Okay,
he
guides us in the right path. Okay, he guides us in the right path. Just think about this. Is gay marriage okay? I'm creating an extreme example, okay? Is gay marriage okay? Well, many churches, they have legalized it. Many churches say this Bible is too old, so it's not to be followed completely. It should be followed to the extent it is convenient for us, or it is relevant for us. But many things, the Old Testament prophets or the apostles did not know, did not experience, and that is why we should not be following everything. And one of the things they say is gay marriage. Paths of righteousness means the right path. The Bible tells us very clearly what is the right path. And Bible tells us very clearly that gay marriage is wrong. Number of places, Old Testament, New Testament, tells us very, very clearly. So God guides us in the paths of righteousness. He not only guides us in the paths of righteousness, but he guides us, my dear friends, he provides guidance whenever we require it. Let me tell you one more story. The story is about a lady, Joan Adams. And Joan Adams had decided or wanted to go to Israel. And so she got all the brochures and everything, and she was going to fill up, you know, that form. And the husband also said, please go. And suddenly she said, no, I think I do not want to go. The Lord is not leading me to go. And she did not apply that particular year. After a few days, the time when the tour was supposed to take off, she landed in hospital and she required a surgery. And she said, I thank the Lord that I did not fill that form, because if I had filled that form, I would have been in some other country, in some other hospital, and I do not know what would have happened to me. The Lord, and she says, the Lord guides me. And the story does not end there. He says, I was in hospital, and there were two people. There was another lady in my room, and that lady was suffering from cancer. And here I was, and I was able to share the love of the Lord with her. She accepted Jesus Christ. And after a few days, even as I was in hospital, I came to know that she had died. And that is where I came to know why the Lord did not allow me to go to Israel, and why he brought me here, why my surgery was required, and what he accomplished through my surgery. These are true stories, all right? These are not made up stories. I get what is called an illustration on my email every day, one illustration every day. And these are some of them. So dear friends, here is a God who never makes a mistake, who guides us, provided we ask for guidance. And we go according to his guidance. All right, so here's God who provides. Secondly, here God promises his presence to us. You know, when it says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. Why? Because you are with me. You are with me. Very important. God never leaves us, and in any circumstances, He promises His presence to us. And we should always be assured of His presence in our lives. I'll tell you later on the advantage of this. All right, let's go to the third thing. As it says that your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Okay, you anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Here is a God who promises protection. He promises provision. He promises His presence. And thirdly, He promises His protection. His rod. Right? What does the shepherd use his rod for? There are two things. Rod and staff. What does he use his staff for? The rod is, of course, the long one. What does he use his staff for? Okay, that's probably the rod. That's probably the rod, okay? To pull the sheep. Okay, but what about the other one? The rod of the animals. Even if a snake is there, it is so strong, the staff is so strong, you know, that he can, if he puts it on the head of the snake, it's going to die. So protection, He provides protection, my dear friends. Even as the shepherd provides protection, so also our Lord provides protection. And through all this, God, what God does for us, He gives us hope in life. Because He is our provider, He is our protector, His presence is there with us. We can live this life with hope. Never lose hope. Let me give you one more example. There was this person called Michael Urbina. And he writes of his experience with God. He says, I was a drug addict. And then I came to know God. I came to know Jesus Christ. And I left drugs. Alright? Probably that's where the testimony should end. But it doesn't end there. And I'm glad it doesn't end there, because a life is not so very simple that you accept Jesus Christ and everything is fine. It doesn't work that way. And this man says that I had the strong urge to go back to drugs, and I went back. I went back. But then God did not leave me. I had my relationship with God, and God did not leave me. And because God did not leave me, there was always hope that I would come back. It was not a hopeless situation. It was not a situation in which he said, there's nothing left for me. And that is what this relationship does. It gives us hope in all circumstances. We know in every circumstance that God is there with us. He has not given up on us. Provided we have that relationship with Him, we are born again. This is the imagery, my dear friends, from the Old Testament. Does Jesus give all these things? Just turn back to John chapter 10. What does Jesus Christ promise as a shepherd? In verse 28. What does He say? I give them eternal life. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, and no one can snatch them out of my hand. Okay? And why does Jesus Christ say that no one can snatch them from my hand? That's given in verse 29. It says, my Father who has given them to me is greater than them all. That is the sovereignty of God the Father. God the Father is sovereign, and for Him anything and everything is possible. Alright? Is that the same with Jesus Christ? Why do we say that? Look at what He says there in verse 30. I and the Father are one. The sovereignty of God the Father is the sovereignty that I also have. And that's why He says that I am the Good Shepherd. And all that has been promised in the Old Testament, and more than that, eternal life is what I will give you. And that is a picture that we get in Revelation chapter 7 also. Here is the Lamb. Alright, I just want you to open this last verse. The Lamb, my dear friends. And where is the Lamb standing? Just look at that particular chapter that we read. Revelation chapter 7. And very quickly, you can tell me, where is the Lamb standing? In the center of? The center of the throne. The center of the throne where God the Father is. There is also the Lamb, my dear friends. That means the authority that God the Father has is also the authority that Jesus Christ has. And Jesus Christ, I told you last time that when we met, that He is the captain of of the new race. If you are born again, we become part of that family of God, and He is our captain. So our captain, my dear friends, is in the center of the throne. He is the one who has all authority. When Jesus Christ said, all authority in heaven and earth have been given to me, this is the authority that He meant. And it is this, with this authority, that He takes care of us and He provides for us. His presence is there with us, and He takes care of us. And that is what we see also in Acts chapter 9 that we read. Here is Peter who goes, and there is a person who is dead, Dorcas, who is dead. And what does he do? He raises her up in the name of the Lord. That means the resurrected Lord. You know, the name of the resurrected Lord has great power. It has power to raise someone even from the dead. That is the power of the resurrected Lord. So, even as we end, what is it that we take away from here today? How would you apply this into your life? We've heard a lot. What is that?
My self-examining.
All right. That's one. What else? Trust in the Lord. Have confidence. Have confidence. Complete confidence in all circumstances, my dear friends. Any circumstances. Let this confidence there be in you that here is our shepherd who is going to take care of all our needs. Alright? This doesn't mean that we are not going to get sicknesses. Doesn't mean that we will not even succumb to sicknesses. Okay? It doesn't mean that. Certainly we can just rest in the confidence, in this confidence that our God is our shepherd who will never leave us. A life of complete trust is a life of complete confidence. So even as we come to the communion table, my dear friends, let us come with grateful hearts for what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. Let's think of the people outside. Think of why they live, how they live. Why do people go after money? Why is it they want more money, more money, more money? Their aim in life, you know, the middle class and the upper middle class and the rich. What is their aim in life? Money. We want money. And why is that? Because they think that is the only thing that can give us confidence in life. That is the only thing that can save us in all circumstances. And God has shown, my dear friends, in this pandemic, you know, that your money is not of any use. You may have all the money, and yet, it's of no use. God has shown that. Our confidence has to be in our Lord. Our confidence has to be. I'm not saying that money is bad. I'm not saying that we should not earn much. But I'm just saying this, that our confidence needs to be in our Lord. Even as we come to the communion table, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord for what He has done for us. And tell the Lord, Lord, I completely trust You. I put myself into Thy hands. As God on His in prayer. Father in heaven, we want to thank You. Thank You for Your word this morning, and thank You for what You have done for us. And thank You, Lord, for not leaving us, God, alone, being our shepherd. Thank You that we are Your sheep. We are not like sheep without a shepherd, but rather one who has a shepherd, who has led us and who is leading us, who will lead us. Thank You, Lord. And even as we partake in the communion today, Lord, we come with grateful hearts, God, for what You have done for us on the cross. In Jesus' name. Amen. Even as we partake in the communion, let us sing one hymn at this time. Hymn number 526, 526. And we'll prepare ourselves to partake in the communion.
Thank you.
Let's open in our communion sheets. A brief form of the order of our communion. Be that truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Let's pray together. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. Remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn to thee, have mercy upon us, pardon, deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what comfortable words the scripture says to all that truly turn to the Lord. Come to me all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. If you confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please be in prayer even as I offer the prayer of consecration. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy dost give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by the one offering of himself a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his passion, death and resurrection, may we partakers of the divine nature through him. On the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you, do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Amen. Let us pray the prayer of humble access together. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather of the crumbs under thy table, for thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to partake of the sacrament of thy Son, Jesus Christ, that we may walk in newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. If you like to partake in the communion, you may stand up where you are, and I will come and give the elements to you all. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is given for thee, preserve thy soul and body unto everlasting life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for thee, and feed on him in thy heart by faith with thanksgiving. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for thee, preserve thy soul and body into everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for thee, and be thankful. The Lord has spoken to us this morning, and he has reminded us that he is a good shepherd. And he has reminded us that we need to have complete confidence in him. As a good shepherd, he has laid down his life for us. And that's what he said. A good shepherd lays down his life for a sheep. Let us learn to rest in him, have confidence in him, and live that life of joy which he has given us. And may the Lord be with each one of us always. Amen. But even as we remain standing, let's turn to the concluding prayer of thanksgiving. It's the prayer of thanksgiving and also prayer where we offer ourselves to the Lord for his service. Let's pray together. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thy humble servants, desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, in the faith in his blood, we and thy whole church may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this abundant duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ the Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.